I met this 6-year-old child with this blank, pale, emotionless face and the blackest eyes, the devil's eyes.
Hey guys, welcome back to Comicgeddon TV, where all geek culture collides. And if you're new to the channel, please click the subscribe button so you don't miss out on future episodes. Today, we're taking a look at the final installment of the Chaos Comics Halloween trilogy, Halloween 3, The Devil's Eyes, which came out in November of 2001. Smith's Grove, Warren County Sanitarium, October 30th, 2001. 2 years ago, Tommy had his last encounter with the evil known as Michael Myers. In the conflict, the Haddonfield Baptist Church blew up and former police chief Brackett died. The townspeople said Tommy Doyle was responsible, that he was insane. We open with Tommy Doyle locked in a room at the sanitarium, alone. His head's been shaved for some reason, and the cult is still in charge of the sanitarium. Wynn has returned once again and is in charge there. The plan is to kill Tommy and make it look like a suicide, to get him out of the picture once and for all. It's here that we learn Halloween 6, The Curse of Michael Myers, and H20 exist in the same continuity as Tommy thinks to himself. I know you're still alive, you son of a bitch. Laurie Strode didn't kill you. I don't care what they said on the news. It's revealed that Laurie Strode has disappeared since she cut off the head of whomever was wearing Michael's mask. Wynn tells Tommy that Laurie Strode is dead, but of course, you're right. Evil never dies. Wynn orders orderly Krug to give him the injection that will stop his heart. But Tommy fights back, knocking them both unconscious and escaping the sanitarium. He steals a car, and there, among the other patients outside, he sees the shape. I knew it! Don't you ever die, you bastard! Tommy crashes through the gate. Somehow the shape had dodged the vehicle. Haddonfield, Illinois, October 31st, 2001. For over 20 years, this small town has lived in mortal dread of the boogeyman. 23 years ago, Lindsay Wallace met the boogeyman, looked into his eyes, and lived to tell the tale. That's what she does now. Tell tales. True stories for a Chicago paper. She's a damn good reporter. Has the awards to prove it. Now she's returned home to tell the biggest story of all. The true story of Michael Myers. Last year, a news report from California stated Michael Myers was dead, decapitated by his sister, Laurie Strode. But after all these years, the people of Haddonfield still fear Halloween. Dozens of murders have taken place here over the past 2 decades, and old habits are hard to break. Most people pack up for the night and drive to Russellville, 30 miles away. It's safer for the children to trick-or-treat there. Lindsay used to love Halloween and scary movies. But after that night 23 years ago, things that go bump in the night hold no attraction for her. That night, in the Doyle house, Lindsay and her playmate Tommy stared into the devil's eyes and came within an inch of dying. She saw the true face of evil, tasted the razor-sharp sensation of total terror since then. Nothing Hollywood has to offer could compare with that night of fear. Besides, who wants to scare themselves for the fun of it when you live in fear? Jump at shadows at age 31, still sleep with the lights on. Lindsay plays back a tape of the news she recorded a year ago to the day. The report of how Laurie Strode was still alive and living under the alias of Carrie Tate, headmistress of the prestigious Hillcrest Academy, where Michael Myers had slaughtered several people trying to get to her and her son. Laurie had stolen the ambulance containing Michael and drove it off the road. As it flipped down the hill, it flung Michael from it and pinned him against a downed tree. Nearby police found the charred remains of an unidentified man whose decapitated body was burned beyond recognition and whose severed head was still missing. Lindsay, too, has the secret files of Dr. Sam Loomis, which she's been studying for her story. She sees a report on the news of how Tommy Doyle escaped Smith's Grove. What are you doing, Tommy? Tommy tracks her down and convinces her they need to work together. Lindsay and Tommy, longtime friends who both survived that night so long ago together because of their babysitter, Laurie Strode. They begin working together, reading the journals of Dr. Loomis, trying to find something, anything, that will help them fight off the boogeyman. November 13th, 1970.
I received an unexpected call from a woman named Hattie Bartok. She says she knows things about Michael. She wants to tell me. She tells me,
Halloween is the night when the curtain between the living and the dead is thinnest. The night when true evil walks the earth. The wearing of the masks to ward off evil spirits, or to become someone else, is a powerful form of magic, and magic can be used for good or evil. Michael was born on November 1st, known in some cultures as the Day of the Dead. I was the midwife who helped deliver the Myers children, all three of them.
No! Michael was born on Halloween, and there were only two Myers children, Judith and Michael.
I'm sorry, Dr. Loomis, but you're wrong. There was another.
Hattie told me Audrey Myers was tortured by an agonizing 3-day labor. Michael was born at 11:57 that night, but his body was stillborn.
At that moment, they hear something upstairs. When they go to check it out, they find a severed head with a candle in it, and three skeletons laying in bed. Out of the shadows behind them, the shape appears. He manages to stab Tommy in the shoulder and gives chase to Lindsay. She escapes the house and runs to the Myers house. This is it. The final confrontation. She's been running for far too long. It's time to make her stand. She goes up to Judith's room and proceeds to brush her hair in front of the same mirror that Michael killed his sister in front of all those years ago. As she sits waiting for Michael, the shape appears behind her.
They're all dead now, Michael. You killed them. Your sisters are both dead.
She tries to take the knife from his hand, but the shape snaps back and lashes out at her. Lindsay stabs him in the eye with a broken shard of glass from the mirror. It's then that Tommy appears in the doorway and shoots him from behind. With the shape on the floor, Tommy pulls the mask off his head. He wants to see Michael's true face, but underneath the mask, Michael is nowhere to be seen. 4 weeks later, Lindsay Wallace visits Smith's Grove. She goes to try and understand the shape, to understand the person who wore Michael's mask. The skull she and Tommy found upstairs that night was in fact Michael's. Laurie Strode had removed Michael's head from his body. So then who was it that carried on Michael's mission? It was a classic textbook case of psychotic personality transference. She needed to relive the original night of terror after she killed Michael in California last year. She took his head as a kind of trophy, but that wasn't enough to make the fantasy real. Over time, she couldn't survive without the idea of Michael. So in essence, she became him. Where there is a family bond, and the Myers case seems to prove this without a doubt, the depth of the personality transference can be incurable. The only curse on the Myers family was mental illness. Although, we can't prove it because we have no records. Dr. Loomis theorized it went back generations, fueled by alcoholism and probably incest. What did you guys think of the twist ending? Laurie Strode has taken up her brother's mantle. This is what was originally planned for the follow-up film to H2O, but instead we got that huge pile of crap that was Resurrection. Laurie did actually decapitate Michael that night. It wasn't a paramedic like stated in Resurrection. It was actually Michael. Or was it? At the beginning of Resurrection, we're reintroduced to Laurie Strode, who's been committed to Smith's Grove Sanitarium. She's been there for a while. Her hair is a lot longer. Her backstory is that she lost her mind after it was revealed the person she decapitated wasn't Michael, but a paramedic. Michael had crushed his throat, so he couldn't speak and swapped clothes with him. We saw this once before at the end of the producer's cut of The Curse of Michael Myers, when Michael swaps clothes with Wynn and disappears into the night. In the second installment of this series, the Journal of Sam Loomis says that Michael was the first of the cursed Myers offspring to be born on that day. We've always been told that Laurie was Michael's younger sister, but we didn't know by how many years. What if it wasn't a matter of years in between them? What if it was a matter of minutes? Michael and Laurie were twins. Michael was supposed to be stillborn, but then came Laurie. And when Michael finally took a breath, what happened then? Could it be that we had it wrong all this time? What if Audrey Myers was told that only one of the infants survived the birth? The one who would fulfill the prophecy was returned to the Myers, while the other was sent off, cast out and adopted by the Strodes. Laurie had no memory of this, but Michael knew because his cult, the cult of Thorn, told him. when Michael escaped and left the paramedic in his place. With Laurie thinking she had killed the real deal, the evil had possessed her, as it did for a brief time her daughter so many years ago. What if the H20 timeline and the Halloween 6 timeline aren't separate after all? What if they actually are the same timeline? The story makes for a great argument as to how the two different timelines could be one and the same. And perhaps with the new Halloween movie coming out in 2018, with Jamie Lee Curtis returning as Laurie Strode, maybe the idea of it being a new timeline could be something the writers are doing to screw with our minds, so we can be surprised when we see it. I really enjoyed the story and how Chaos Comics wove the events of Halloween 6 and H20 together seamlessly, and even left room for Resurrection to also be a part of that same timeline, along with this miniseries. Issues 1 and 2 of Chaos Comics Halloween series took place right after the events of Curse of Michael Myers. And then we have issue number 3, which took place a year after the events of H20. So maybe Laurie Strode actually did survive that fall in Resurrection. Maybe that was her faking her death once again. After all, Michael was there to see it happen. It could be. And whatever happened to John Tate, Laurie Strode's son, who was one of the stars of H20? If Michael Myers wants to completely remove his family from the face of the planet, what happened to John? Why doesn't John make an appearance in any of these comics or in any of the movies? And then we have Danny, who at the time of Curse of Michael Myers was 6 years old. It seemed like he was going to be the next to be chosen by the Cult of Thorn to take Michael's place as the killer. Whatever happened to him? There's so much that the comics and the movies haven't yet explored. I don't think this is a good time to do yet another reboot. Why not just continue the series, put these three comics and the Devil's Due Publishing comic and the First Death of Laurie Strode comics into continuity with the original movies? Instead of making the Halloween franchise branch off into different timelines, like 1, 2, and H20 and Resurrection were one timeline, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, and 6 were another timeline, why not have them all one cohesive timeline? I think these three comics did a perfect job at combining the two timelines, and then even pay homage to the Rob Zombie Halloween movies by making them an in-film, based on true events style movies. Kind of like a movies within a movie type deal. Was very much popularized by Scream 2. And what about Jamie Lloyd's son? I almost got the idea that what if the baby from Curse of Michael Myers actually grew up to be John Tate, in which Laurie Strode adopted, you know, as her own. But that wouldn't work since there's like 3 or 4 years in between Curse of Michael Myers and H20. So that wouldn't work. What about all these things? There's so much that needs to be explored. You know, they could kill off Michael Myers and have somebody else pick up his mantle and take on his legacy. There's so much these movies have yet to explore. It doesn't have to be the same killer as long as they keep the same idea of the shape. The shape could be anyone. That's why Michael keeps the mask on. It could be anybody. But I really enjoyed this story and how Chaos Comics wove the events of Halloween 6 and H20 together, and even left room for Resurrection to also be a part of that same timeline along with this miniseries. Let me know what you guys think in the comments below. Until next time, guys, happy Halloween.